Are we ready? You ready?
Yep.
We'll move all the.
Beautiful day.
Good. Okay. I wanted to let you know that the Soul Sister class, I'm short, I'm so sorry. The Soul Sister class will be having a video series on God Provides starting next week. The fifth quarter for the youth is this Friday night. We need homemade desserts. If you will bring those to the church, please, before, 5 o'clock or so Kyle will have time to get them over to where they need to be. We would be greatly appreciated. It could be homemade or store-bought, but we do need desserts, so please participate. And then the youth are having a Halloween party, a boo bash, on Halloween night at 7 o'clock. Come in your costume, and we'll have a costume contest. We're going to have a Thanksgiving celebration here at Pleasant Hill, November 15th at 6 p.m. That'll be a Sunday night. And then watch for these and future events on the website. Y'all know how to access that on pleasanthillphum.net. Then we have bulletins over here, and you can ask me. Please feel free to find out the information. Don't let anything important slip by. If you have anything you want announced, please let me know, and I'll get it announced for you on Sunday morning. The Wednesday night ladies' Bible study will meet at Doris Phillips' house at 6 o'clock. If you have questions about that, you can see Jenny Creekmore. God bless.
That was on the 22nd. Well, 2 days before that, somebody on the stage will turn 50 years old and would like lots of presents. And it's not any of them. I'm just saying. Yeah, okay. I'll be surprised. Oh, I don't know about that.
Well, we're glad to be here. We're glad that you're here today. We're looking to get ready to celebrate. Yeah, and on that note, Amy and I are wedding anniversary today, 18 years today.
Aww, happy anniversary. You're a lucky man.
Gathered together this morning, we ask that your spirit would just anoint this time in the morning for us. Lord,
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never. Song again, whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then your holy name, Jesus.
God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire.
Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire. God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, restore the joy I had, I have wandered, bring me back. In this darkness, lead me through until all I see is you. Yeah, God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. I am a soul on fire. Lord, restore the joy I had, I have wandered, bring me back. In this darkness, lead me through until all I see is you. Yeah, God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire.
Lord, let me burn for you again. Let me return to you again. Come on.
Lord, let me burn for you again. Let me return to you again.
God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire.
Amen. Thank you.
our lives, especially today, can be pretty chaotic and crazy with the demands on our time, and our schedules seem busier than ever. And we get so caught up in trying to keep up that oftentimes we neglect the intimate and the personal times with God during the week and during our lives. And you know, the world is shouting at us to do this and do that and come this way and go that way, and God is just telling us to be still. And one of my favorite things about Sunday mornings and about worship is that we get the opportunity to do that. We get to lay all the stuff that we have to deal with during the week, all our troubles and all our burdens, we get to lay those down, and we just get to be still. And the Bible says not only to be still, but to be still and to know that He is God. And He is so much bigger than any problem or burden, any deadline, any schedule. And in His presence, we find comfort and we find healing. We find forgiveness. We find restoration. And so my prayer this morning for all of us is that we just take time to be still. We take time to access the same power that raised Christ from the grave. We have access to that power this morning. And just to put aside all those things that are just competing and vying for our attention, and the distractions that rob us of this time. We are in the presence of God and with His body. And we need to just take time and be still and let Him move. Let Him be God. And just know that He is God. Let's pray. God, we just thank You this morning for who You are, and for Your Son, and for the forgiveness and the grace and the mercy that He's extended us. God, we just pray that we don't leave here unchanged, that we allow Your presence and we allow Your Spirit to move and work through us and in us, God. That we just clear our minds of the distractions, and that we just enter into a time of worship. God, we just love You, and we thank You for all the things that You've done. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Soul rests in Your embrace, for I am. All right. Hang on a minute, Kyle. Can't leave yet. Okay. We collected money last week for pastor and youth pastor appreciation, and I'm pleased to say that everyone gave from their hearts, and they should, because we're lucky to have the families here that we do that are supporting our church. And Kyle and Emily are new to this. He's taken over the youth, and they're doing a great job, but I don't think anybody realizes how much time that the youth pastor and his wife and our pastor and Amy and even all the kids spend, you know, between the fall festivals and the vacation Bible schools and everything that goes on at church. We can't say thank you enough. And so if you get a chance, thank them, tell them you love them. And just want to let y'all know that, Kyle, this is a gift for you. And in the traditional service, Kenny and Amy, you'll be getting a gift. So we didn't want anybody to be forgotten here.
I just want to say a quick word, too. Thank you, guys, from the bottom of my heart. Emily's taking care of the nursery this morning, and I know that she's very thankful, too. But we're just blessed. We're blessed with a wonderful church family. I spent some time... one of the kids in the youth yesterday came out. You know, I'm involved with Outreach Outdoors, and we were shooting rifles. And I just told her, I said, we're blessed to be a part. I know we're still new to this, but we've got a wonderful church family. And what we get from here, I want my teens, my kids. I call them my kids now, so I guess I'm not too new to it. But I want my kids to get what Emily and I get from here and what you guys get from here. So what I do, I can't do it without your help. So from the bottom of my heart, thank you very much.
Hey, man, we thank you very much. We are certainly blessed to be here, and we're thankful for the opportunity that we have to serve and to be a part of Pleasant Hill. And over the past, I guess, 7 years. I think we're in our seventh year. It's been a wonderful blessing, and God willing, there's many more ahead of us. And we do want to thank Kyle and Emily for the work they do. We've been very fortunate, very blessed over the past few years to have the youth directors that we've had and the help that they've had during that time as well. When Chris was here, and then God sent us Eric and Kimberly, and they did a fantastic job, and now Kyle and Emily. And so we're very excited about the direction of our youth program and the sustainability with solid leadership that we've had over the past few years goes an awful long ways in developing and keeping the people that we've raised in church. We don't mind if they get to a certain age and trying to, you know, that when you get in your early 20s, it's a very, very difficult time. It's a very hard time in your life about trying to figure out where you belong and where you're going to be and how to make those decisions. And we have just a very, very short time to possibly instill within them some a spiritual compass to guide them and lead them, and direct them during that difficult time. And while they may go to a different church when they get to that age, depending on where they may be, if it's in college or move off to work or whatever it is, that's fine and wonderful. We just want them committed during that time to hold on to Christ and to follow God's leadership through that. And so we're very thankful for the, like I said, the dependable and consistent leadership that we've had within our youth over the past few years. So we're thankful for that and for your support in that, the way you help them financially and with your volunteers. And it's like I said, we're just very excited about going forward, especially with, as a dad, having one in the youth and got three more coming along that, Lord willing, one day will be in it as well. So we're very thankful for the work they do. This morning, we're going to read you some passages here out of Judges, and we're going to skip around and read different places in Corinthians and things along that line. And what we want to talk about real quick, and you know, in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, God makes this habit out of using things that most folks wouldn't expect God to use. You know, He makes a habit out of it in the Old Testament about using people that most people would not expect God to use. If it's, you know, it was if it wasn't the firstborn son, God would often pick the secondborn. Or it wasn't the biggest, you know, the way they would pick their king was the one that looked the most kingly, you know, the biggest guy, the strongest guy, the one that towers above everybody else, the strongest one of the bunch is the way they began. They set out picking their kings, and we find God picks kings very different than they did. They picked one that they didn't even invite to the picking contest. I mean, you know, David wasn't even invited. When the prophet showed up to determine who was going to be king and anoint, they didn't even call David in from the field because, well, we all know that it couldn't be David. I mean, David's just too little, and, you know, he's got his issues, whatever they might be. But through the Old Testament into the New Testament, God continues to use things that people would never think God would use or could use to do the things that He does. And I believe with all my heart that the reason God does this is so that He will be glorified in when these great things happen, that you can only look and say, obviously God done this. And for us, that's quite a challenge. It's challenging for us to put ourselves in a place to where we become fully dependent upon God to do what God desires to do in our life. And in the process of us putting ourselves in that place, it requires at times us making ourselves small so that God can be extremely big in our life. And we're very reluctant to do that. We're reluctant to put ourselves in positions of where willfully we make ourselves little so that the greatness of God can be displayed through our lives. Now, you can call it being humble or practicing humility or obedience or whatever it is. But ultimately, I think the challenge we have through life, as especially in the place that we live, is committing our ways and committing ourselves to God and knowing that God does bless and God does help and God does lift up and God does make strong. But there's times where God needs us and desires us and calls us to be very little so that He can be very big and the world can see that around us. And that's extremely challenging for us. I mean, that makes us very vulnerable in times like that and puts us in positions that we don't normally like to be in. But if you go back through the Bible, you find where God uses little things all through the Bible to do very, very big things. I mean, if it's, like I said earlier, the little shepherd boy that nobody would have picked with five little stones that he decides to throw to bring down, you know, the biggest enemy that that Israel had faced during that up until that time. And I mean, whatever it might be, if it's Samson with the jawbone of a, you know, of a donkey to be his greatest weapon to slay an army, you know, or whatever it might be. In the New Testament, as Jesus sets off to the side and teaches some of his greatest lessons with some of the smallest things that he sees around him. If it's the widow throwing in a widow's mite, or if it's the mustard seed, and as he talks about the greatness and the power of faith to move mountains, he uses some of the smallest things in order to do that. So this morning, what we want to talk about is that there's a lot of opportunities in all of our lives to see the power of God in small areas, little things, little areas of our life. I would go as far to say this, that my faith has been shaped in through things that I've watched God do in my life. I mean, my faith has been solidified in certain areas of my life about believing what God can do or believing what God will do through experiences that I've had through God. And it's no different than what you've experienced as well. It's no different than the things you go through. It's the prayers that I saw answered in my life, or that I experienced being answered in my life as a 16-year-old. Or, you know, or as a young man, or, you know, as a young father. And a lot of times those life-shaping or those faith-shaping moments usually go untalked about. We usually don't talk about them a whole lot because they're so small at times. They're so little at times. You would think that people might think you're crazy. You know, if your faith was built upon this solid foundation of what began as just a little small stone, something that God did in your life, just where he made himself so real and so available. You know, as a preacher and a pastor, you would like to stand up and talk about, you know, maybe times of where you were digging deep into God's word, or, you know, or you were in the middle of a fast, or in the middle of a great prayer time, or a great time of, you know, committing your heart to Christ, and you had poured out and blood as sweat moments, you know, where you're just pouring yourself out. And then in the middle of that, you have these great revelations that just nail down your faith and cast out doubt and pushes fear aside. You'd love to be able to point at those moments and say, if we will commit ourselves along this line and we will commit to this type of prayer life, or, you know, we would bring back the practice of fasting, we could really see these powerful movements and these moments in our life. And you would like to, with a straight face, say, that's how it happened to me. But the truth is, greater, more powerful revelations come in my life in smaller areas than in those big things that Christians are supposed to be doing. You know, I told you so many of these stories. If it's the 17-year-old that car's not running right, and you don't have any other options, and there is no more money, and deadlines are coming, as important as a deadline can be to a 17-year-old or 18-year-old, and it's God intervening in those moments and providing a way. You know, those are not the type of things you build sermon series around. Those are the type of things that you recall and you remember and your faith is built upon. You know, if it's little things, the breaking of a fever with a child, you know, or if it's the setting aside of differences over a dispute within a congregation, nothing major, but a lot of times it's just small things where God's hand is so evident. And really it seems to be a whole lot easier to see the power of God's hand in these small things than it is in these places of where we take control. Because if we're not careful, we will say, because I committed myself to this type of prayer and because I really got into it, I made this happen. Or because I committed myself to this type of fast and because I, if we're not careful, we will make ourselves big in the process of trying to tell everybody how big God is. But what we do in return is make ourselves big. So in these little areas where, you know, maybe I don't even know if anybody wants to hear about them, they're so small. You know, I don't know what the point is, other than the point and the foundation that it creates for me. Well, all through our life, I think we throw away some of these small moments to see God's hand in such a powerful way. I'm going to read you some scripture here shortly about the way we saw this unfold in the Old Testament and moving into the New Testament. And one of the examples that I want to use is Gideon. Gideon's a perfect example of this. And I love God's forwardness, and we'll talk about that here in just a minute, and why God says you need to be little. You need to be small. God knows Gideon. He knows the people. He knows us. He knows what's in our hearts. He knows what we wrestle with. And God's very straightforward about this. And God explains to Gideon, you need to be little so that when this happens, everybody will know I did it. You just can't underestimate the power of small things and little things in the hands of God. If it's actions or whatever it might be from us, you can't underestimate what God is trying to do in our life when we decide to be little and let Him be very big. Excuse me. We get scripture like this in Corinthians as Paul talks about weakness and strength when it comes to God. 1 Corinthians 1:27 says this, "But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty." 2 Corinthians 12:10 says, "Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong." There's this, you know, little opposite thing working here. In the first part of it, he says that God uses things that people wouldn't expect Him to use to do great things with. Don't underestimate these small things, these little things, these weak things, the things that you wouldn't give a second thought to. Don't underestimate the power of a small conversation. Don't underestimate the power of a little prayer. Don't underestimate the power of these things, even in our moments of weakness, where God does mighty things. You know, in the second part of this is when he talks about being strong in times of weakness. All he's simply saying is that when I can't stand is when I stand the strongest, because God is doing it for me. This is the lesson he teaches Gideon. You need to be little so that I can do this for you. That's what Paul is saying. That when I'm weak, that's when I'm strong, because that's when I'm trusting. That's when I'm leaning. That's when I'm fully relying on Him. But the problem with putting ourselves in weak places or allowing ourselves to be little so God can build us up to make us big or make big things happen in our life, that in these moments we're extremely vulnerable. And nobody likes that. Nobody likes to be vulnerable. We like to know how this story, we like to know what's going to happen. We like to know that we're in control. We like to know that by our own hands we can do it. If nobody else does, and if the good things don't happen, I've still got it. Gideon gets himself into a position, into a place of where he sits down and he makes the determination that if God doesn't do this, we just simply don't do it. We don't do it because we can't. The problem, the situation is bigger than we are. And it starts off not with Gideon narrowing down his army. It starts off a little different. Let me read the first part of a passage in Judges here. Judges 6:36 says this, "And Gideon said unto God," now listen to this prayer. Now this is no little thing that he's talking about. "If thou wilt save Israel by my hand as thou hast said." Now before we get into the rest of this, understand what Gideon is facing. Gideon is not facing any small task. He is not facing any little thing. This is a very big situation in front of him. This is a big thing that he's asking of God. "If you're going to deliver Israel by the working of my hands," here we go. He begins to lay out these guidelines then. "I need to know that. I need to know that you're going to do this. I need to know that you're with me in this. I need to know that when I am weak, you're going to be strong. That when I am little, you're going to be big. I need to know that the things that I can't do, that you're going to be with me to do these things." And so what Gideon decides to do is he asks God in a very simple little prayer, in a very little thing, he asks Him about a fleece in a very little way. And I've often thought, if I was in Gideon's shoes and I'm about to lead a battle into lead an army into battle and talking about the deliverance of a nation, I would probably be reluctant to describe how I come to the conclusion that God is with me. Probably. You know, if I'm one of those that's in the army And the guy stands before me and says, we're going into battle against these enormous foes and these great armies to do something wonderful that's going to rewrite history and change our future. And it's going to do all these great things. And we're doing that because I got up and a fleece was wet. You know, I'd be reluctant to get behind that. You know, I'd be reluctant to sign up for battle with somebody who is coming to conclusions along that line, because that's not what we like. We don't like those little things that make big decisions for us. We don't like making ourselves vulnerable in a place of where we ask God that you've got to, because if you don't, we can't. But this is the prayer that Gideon makes. Gideon offers up a simple prayer in a simple manner, and he asks God to do to make himself known and to let Gideon know that he is with him. And so here's the prayer. Now listen, I'm not saying you should or you shouldn't run home and lay out a garment and ask God to either wet it or not for guidance. That's not what I'm talking about. What I am talking about is believing that God is present enough to be concerned about very, very small areas and very little areas. What if we were convinced that God was truly with us because of these little ways where his hand is undeniable in our life? Little things. Let me read this here. It's a passage. Here's the prayer that he prays. It says, behold, I will put a fleece of wool in the floor, and if the dew be on the fleece only, and it will and it be dry up on all the earth beside, then I shall know that thou wilt save Israel by my hand, and as thou hast said. And it was so, for he rose early in the on the morrow and thrust the fleece together and wring the dew out of the fleece, a bowl full of water. And Gideon said unto God, let not that anger be hot against me, and I will speak but this once. Let me prove, I pray thee, but this once with the fleece. Let it now be dry only upon the fleece, and upon all the ground let there be dew. And God did so that night, for it was dry upon the fleece only, and there was dew on all the ground. And this is Gideon putting out a fleece. If the fleece is wet, I know you're with me. He gets up, and the fleece was wet. The next night, he puts it down, and he says, one more time. If the fleece is dry and I get up, I know you're with me. He gets up the next morning, and the fleece is dry. And he offers up these simple prayers in these very difficult and these very hard moments. And he's building his faith on these seemingly small things that's unfolding in his life. And as I look back on my life, I've done the exact same thing in some capacity or another, maybe not knowing it or not even realizing it. But when I'm in distress and when I'm in hard times and I'm going through maybe a moment of doubt or a spiritual storm that rages in my mind, I'll tell you, my mind goes to places in my life or things that's happened in my life that probably people don't even know about, because it's not worth telling to most people. I mean, to most people, it's not worth telling. I mean, it's about maybe a small conversation. It's affirmation. It's a song that I heard at this particular time that God sent my way. It's a small conversation that the people that was saying it may not even remember they said it. You know, when I go back and I look at the foundation, these blocks that I've built my faith upon, that's cast out doubt and cast out fear and has led me into battle in so many areas of my life, and usually those rocks are pretty small that I've built this upon. You know, and I would love to be able to be in that place all the time of where I can step back and I can look at these little things and these small things and these areas of where God is so evident in my life and be so convinced that he's with me in the big things. Be so convinced that he's with me in the hard times, in the distressed times, in the times when I want to give up, in the times when the battle is so overbearing and the enemy is so big. I would love to be able to look at small little things and be convinced of these things. You know, Amy and I, we celebrate our 18th wedding anniversary today. And, you know, I'm not saying it's no small thing, because it certainly is. Let's get back over here. been extremely blessed and very fortunate. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to say, to see God's hand in our 18th wedding anniversary just as strong as if we saw God's hand restore our marriage through a very difficult, hard time? Wouldn't it be nice to be able to take today and be able to build great steps of faith on moments like today? Moments like today where everything seems to be okay and everything's in working order and everything, I mean, you know, families together. Why can't in these moments we see God's hand so prevalent and evident? Because it is. It is. But it seems like we have to have those moments of where God just drags us up out of the dirt and out of the miry clay and sets our feet on a solid rock and does all of these big things. And I go back through the Bible and I read about Moses with a staff and how that staff become this monument of which he built his faith upon because of God's hand in that piece of wood. You know, I read about David and these five smooth stones as he picks them up, and it propels David's faith into a remarkable place. You know, and Elijah with so many little things, if it's a cape or this mantle that he uses or whatever it is, to Jesus pointing at little children that come by and says, the kingdom of heaven is like this. Now, he didn't say the kingdom of heaven is like this when he made the blind man see, or the kingdom of heaven is like this when he resurrected the little girl back to life, when he raised the dead, or when he fed the thousands, or he turned water into wine. No, he took a little child walking by in the middle of the day, nothing going on, and saying, this is the kingdom of heaven. Why can't we see the kingdom of heaven in that? You know, why do we have to have those big moments? You know, why do we have to have, and I'm convinced, you know, that God, through parables that Jesus teaches us that if you want to see God in the big, you've got to be able to see Him in the small. You've got to be able to see Him in the little. If you want to be able to see God with thousands of dollars, you got to see Him with 10. You know, or if you want to see God move in ministry to where you're reaching thousands, you've got to be able to see Him when you're standing before nine. You know, when I go back to thinking about the times when Amy and I started, and there was two little churches that were there, and, you know, one had a handful and one had less than a handful. You know, as we got started that Sunday morning, and very early on in ministry, without a doubt in my mind, God was very present that morning. With two combined churches of less than 15, God was extremely present. You know, and I don't know why we can't see God with the nine and we feel like we have to have the 900. You know, I don't know why we can't see the kingdom of heaven through the workings of a little child, but we have to see it through the resurrection of the dead, and we have to see it when the thousands are fed. What's wrong with letting these moments like today and the things that are going on today be building blocks that solidify our faith for the battles that's coming ahead? Let me read you the next passage. The next passage here is where Gideon begins to narrow down his army to fight the Midianites that are ahead. And listen to this conversation. And then the Lord said unto Gideon, the people are yet too many. Bring them down into the water, and I will try them for thee there. This is the place of where God tells Gideon that you're too big. You're just too big. That if I do this for you, you're going to take credit for it. If I do this for you, you're going to stick your chest out, and you're going to boast about it, and you're going to say, look at what we've done. Look what kind of leader that I am, or look what kind of strength that we have. Look how great we are. So God is asking Gideon to be little and to be small. So Gideon takes his men down to the branch, and depending on how they drink water, he decides, he narrows thousands and thousands down to about 300 to go out and overcome an army. Now, had he not done this, I don't know if we would have Gideon's story with us today. But God is asking Gideon that you need to allow yourself to be little so that I can be very... You need to allow yourself to be extremely vulnerable right now so that I can be very powerful in your life right now. So that we can take these moments and we can build faith upon them and we can do great things with it. And the Bible teaches, let me go on to the next passage here. 1 Corinthians 5 and 6, listen to this. It says, your glorying is not good. Know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? And the reason I want to bring this up is for this purpose. Listen, number one, not only are in good ways and small things can we see God's hand do really powerful things, but if you don't Listen, small bad things can lead to very big bad things in the future. And I don't think we pay attention to that. Just because we don't, you know, if we were to put a list of sins up on the wall and say, just because we're not a part of these and we must be okay. You know, just because we're not a part, you know, we don't have maybe murderers, you know, running loose in our midst or whatever it might be, because we're not, you know, addicts, or because we're not whatever, you know, whatever these social sins that the world has described as taboo in our current context and culture that we're living in today, if we're not a part of these big things, then we must be okay. Well, the way the Bible describes sin and disobedience, that just a little bit of it, boy, can mess up a whole bunch of stuff. Just a little bit of it can really misdirect an entire life. As a matter of fact, go on to the next one, if you will. Matthew 13:31, this is where Jesus uses the mustard seed. Let me read the passage from James. Go to the next one, if you will, real quick. James 3:3, listen to this, one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible. Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold, also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet they are turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the reason I like this passage is because it talks about huge things that little things impact. You know, a 1,000-pound horse is directed by putting a small bit and a bridle in its mouth. I had a horse, we had a little pony one time. It was a Shetland pony, the meanest animal I ever come across in my life. Terrible little animal. I thought it was possessed. It would bite you. I mean, it would swim lakes to get to you to bite you. I mean, it absolutely, for whatever reason, it was mean. And we put a bit in that little thing's mouth, and man, he would pitch a fit, and he would buck, and he would do all sorts. We'd have to tie him down to the bumper of a truck to get a bit in this little thing's mouth. But once you got the bit in his mouth, for a little boy, this big old strong creature, well, he was guided wherever you want to take him. Pull him to the right, he'll go to the right. Pull him to the left, he'll go to the left. You'd be surprised how these little things impact our life in tremendous ways. Oftentimes they go, you know, we don't acknowledge them, or we don't give them enough credit. We don't understand the weight that they carry sometimes. It talks about great ships and how great winds push these ships one side to the next, and how they go through storms and they go over the sea. And this ship is directed by a small rudder that whichever way the captain of the ship decides for it to go, the rudder determines that. And then it talks about the tongue. It says that the whole body, listen to the way it reads, it says that the tongue is a little member and it boasteth great things. And there's a scripture where it talks about the tongue, and it talks about in order to get the body in line and get this life in line, that little tongue has to be reeled in, because the way it decides to go is the way the whole body's going. You know, the Bible tells us that we will give an account for every idle conversation that we have. You know, these little things that we toss aside and we think it's no big deal, believe it or not, it's really driving, guiding, leading us in who we are. You know, it's what defines me as a pastor is not what you see up here on Sunday mornings, but it's what goes on Mondays and Tuesdays and Wednesdays. What defines you as a Christian, it's not the smile that you put on when you're around everybody. It's not the right words you say when everybody's listening. It's some of these small things that we do that directs us. And when nobody's around, and when the things that are unfolding in your life that only you know about, those thoughts, those ideas, the things that are conceived within our own minds that redirect what's happening and where we're going and where we're going to end up. Listen, this morning, if we're talking about a great battle to where we're putting thousands of lives on the line, Gideon makes a decision with a little, small fleece. And then he takes a very small army into battle. Listen, this morning, there's not a doubt in my mind that all of us has got big stuff going on in our life. Don't discount those small areas where God's hand can be so evident that you can build faith upon. You know, don't discount those little moments, those small conversations, those those gentle words, those little things every now and then, the way that we interact with somebody, maybe if we don't want to be interacting with somebody, and nobody else knows about it, nobody sees us, and we can just act any old way we want to. Don't throw away that small moment, because you can turn your whole life in those small moments if you're not careful. So let me encourage you this morning. I know there's things that's going on in your life. You don't have to have a shooting star fall from heaven. You don't have to have Gabriel show up at your doorstep knocking on your door telling you what's got to be done. You haven't got to have a great revelation that knocks you out of your seat onto the ground before you understand God is very real in your life. As a matter of fact, you're probably not going to see that. But what you do need to be is you need to be in tune to that still small voice that has a tremendous impact on where you end up in life. We're going to get them. Jennifer, you want to come around and get us a song? We'll invite you to come pray this morning. I know that in times like this, Sunday mornings here, the, you know, last Sunday of October, just a regular old normal Sunday. It's not Easter. It's not Christmas. It's not homecoming. We're about to have a 2 or 3 minute altar call, and how insignificant that may seem to a lot of people. Do not discount these small things and the power of God's hand to be so evident in these little ways. Treat them for what they are. Opportunities for God to be extremely big in your life. Stand up, if you will. Stand to your feet. Let me say a word of prayer and we'll let them sing. Father, we thank you for this time together and for the opportunity to be here. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the ways of which you lead us, the ways that you guide us, the ways that you help us. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the everyday things that encourage us. God, the ways that we see your hands when we get up in the morning. Father, the small things, the small conversations, the right song at the right time, the right verse at the right time, the right friend at the right time. Lord, that propels us into great journeys of faith. And God, I pray that we don't discount those moments, but we understand the weight of them. Lord, as Gideon did and as Paul understands, the weight of these little weak moments in our life. And God, as we turn this over to you, we just trust in you in Christ's name. Amen. I invite you to come pray.